8 o'clock. So and the speaker and the moderator are here. So let me first introduce the speaker, Dr. Sripriya Srinivas. She's a senior consultant in diagnostic radiology at Global Hospitals Chennai. She did her MBBS from Jipma Montessori and her diploma in radio diagnosis from Madras Medical College. She subsequently did her fellowship in clinical radiology in UK. She's in love with the liver, and so her major interests are cross-sectional imaging in liver tumors, liver transplantations, and pediatric radiology. She has several peer-reviewed papers to her credit, and she actively participates in many academic activities. To moderate the session, I am honored to introduce Dr. Jayaraj Govindraj. Well, Chennai will know him, but people who are rest of the country, non-radiologists, may not know him. So I will just give a brief introduction. He's a senior consultant and head of radiology at Apollo Speciality and Cancer Center at Nandanam. Dr. Jayaraj did his MBBS from St. John's Medical College, Bangalore, and his MD in radio diagnosis from Bangalore Medical College. Subsequently, he moved to Chennai and joined Apollo Hospitals, where he did his diploma in National Board. He's been conferred the Fellowship of Indian College of Radiology, and he has done advanced training in MRI in US, UK, and the Netherlands. Dr. Jayaraj is also trained in radio frequency ablation in Italy. He's the immediate past chairman of ICRI and ISPR, and has also been the past president and secretary of and Pondicherry branches. He has delivered several orations, and his area of interest is general radiology, oncoimaging, musculoskeletal, head and neck, name it, and he does it. And the main thing which he himself has said, and I know personally, is that he greatly promotes interdisciplinary interactions, and he's the poster boy for imaging and ultrasound. Thank you, Dr. Jayaraj, so much for joining us and accepting when you, I know you have a very busy schedule.
Thank you.
Sripriya, if you're ready, you can start sharing your screen. You're muted, Sripriya, just unmute yourself.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Justin, be his name.
Sure.
Put this.
You can go to your slideshow now.
Yes, ma'am. Go to slideshow. Beginning. Yeah.
Perfect. Perfect.
Can you hear me, ma'am?
Yeah.
Okay. First of all, thank you, Dr. Vidya, ma'am. Thank you, Patta, sir, for giving this opportunity. As you said, I'm more into liver radiology right now. That's just because I've been working in liver transplant units for some time. But having said that, my early part of my training has been dedicated to, especially ultrasound abdomen is something which is most satisfying. And when you asked me to give this talk, I thought, am I the right person to do this? But then I thought I should look back on my student days and what I was doing in the UK. And most of it was general radiology, abdominal radiology, communicating to the clinicians. So I thought, why not take it and do it? I will try to do my best justice to this talk. And I hope Dr. Jayaraj can support me as well. And I'm hoping for an interactive discussion after the presentation, ma'am.
That's given. That's a given, not to worry.
Okay. Okay. So like Dr. Patta said, he said ultrasound essentials for surgeons. The overview of my talk is like this. I thought briefly we'll talk about ultrasound physics. When I say physics, all I want to know discuss is how we, when we acquire the images, why they look the way they do, and how we interpret them. And some common scenarios that we encounter, this is the way I thought, looking at abnormal liver functions, acute abdomen, what is the role of ultrasound for adults, for children, and in trauma. In fact, me and Dr. Jayaraj were discussing today that I think 40 minutes is not enough to even talk about fully about ultrasound abdomen itself. So maybe if you want another session, with another speaker, maybe we can go into further details. But as of now, this is what I thought may be relevant. We can add more in the discussions session. So when we talk about physics of ultrasound, we have the probe, we hold the probe in our hands. This probe has piezoelectric crystals. So what it does is the current that is that passes through the probe is converted into mechanical energy, which is sound waves, which are sent into the body. Now, when these sound waves encounter the tissues, there is a what is called an acoustic interface. When it crosses tissues which have different physical properties, the sound wave gets reflected back, and that's what forms an echo. So the probe then converts these returning sound waves back into images on the monitor. So it does both ways. It converts electrical energy into sound energy, and then the returning sound energy back into electrical energy. So other things also happen. The sound waves can get absorbed, they can get scattered and refracted. But what helps in forming the image is the reflected sound waves, which is called the echoes. So this is the usual mode that we see in ultrasound, a B mode. B standing for brightness mode. So whatever structural information we want, we use it, we get it using different shades of gray, which means different brightness levels depending upon the strength of the returning echoes. So if you see here, what we can see is, this is a liver, an image of a liver. So that's our probe, that's a skin surface. We apply adequate gel and we take the scan. So as we come down, we see different shades of gray. This is all the liver tissue. So if we see soft tissue, they offer some acoustic impedance. So some of the echoes will get reflected back, which is what helps us form these images. This here is a blood vessel. What happens when the beam hits a blood vessel is there is no significant reflection of sound. All the energy goes through the blood, so it appears black. This is why all blood containing or fluid containing structures will appear black. So blood is black, our liver is gray. What happens when the beam strikes the diaphragm? This is the diaphragm here. You get a bright echogenic line. That is because when the beam passes from the liver and hits the diaphragm, there's a significant difference in the acoustic impedance, which accounts for a significant amount of echo sound getting reflected back. So you get a strong echo, which is why the diaphragm appears as a bright white line. That it's a big specular reflector. And not seen in this case, but if it hits any stone, what happens is a gallstone or a renal stone, almost all the incident energy will get reflected back. Literally nothing goes through. So you get a bright shadow with a shadow, a bright echo with a shadowing behind it. So this is how the liver looks on ultrasound. The way ultrasound works is initially the images appear very fuzzy, very grainy. But as we keep looking at these images, we can gradually they all appear to make sense. So the way I thought was I'll show you lots of images, and so that some of them, as we keep seeing them again and again, they will start looking familiar. Now, the same properties that I've said, I would like to reiterate in a different way. So whenever sound passes through a totally homogeneous medium, so this is a gallbladder, it is filled with bile. So when it passes through a homogeneous medium, there is no interface here happening. So because of that, no sound is getting reflected back. It all goes through. The medium appears anechoic or cystic. This is the main clincher for ultrasound. Ultrasound helps us differentiate a solid from a cystic tissue, because when there is no reflection of sound waves, it will appear completely black. The same gallbladder, if it has a gallstone, then what happens? There is an interface with a significant difference. There is a large acoustic difference here as it hits a gallstone. Almost all the incident energy will be reflected. So this can happen with stones. It can happen if you hit a rib cage, if there is air. So all these will cause a bright echo with shadowing. So the three terms which we must be familiar with while looking at ultrasound are anechoic, a structure which has no echoes. Most likely it's a fluid structure. Hypoechoic is when a structure appears darker than the surrounding parenchyma. It's usually something inflammatory, some pathology, that is what will appear hypoechoic. Hyperechoic is when there's a significant acoustic difference, so it's reflecting the sound. It appears brighter than the surrounding. Stones, air and bones commonly will appear bright. Fat also appears brighter. Another feature of any fluid containing structure is because it is an echoic structure. So if you see here, this is a liver. There is a cyst here. Now, because it is totally anechoic, the area behind or the area that is lying below that cyst will appear much more brighter than the surrounding liver tissue. This is called posterior acoustic enhancement. So we are strengthening the echoes behind because they have not been attenuated by any liver tissue here. So the returning echo from these areas that lie underlying a cyst will be stronger. This is commonly seen in cysts or any fluid containing structure like gallbladder or urinary bladder. Another way to look at this is for hemangiomas. Why do hemangiomas appear bright? We call them usually as homogeneous hyperechoic lesions. So this is a section of the liver. So we can see the same homogeneous echoes. And we see these discrete bright areas sitting here. The reason for that is hemangiomas contain numerous acoustic interfaces which are formed between the walls of the cavernous sinuses and the blood within them. So that accounts for a significant amount of reflection of echoes, which is why they appear hyperechoic. So using the same principle of reflection of sound energy, we are able to generate the images for different pathologies. Next, from the B mode, if we come to the Doppler mode, Doppler uses the principle of Doppler effect, which is there is a change in frequency of the returning sound wave whenever we are interrogating a moving particle. That frequency shift correlates to the velocity and the direction of motion. There are two ways to look at this. One is color Doppler, the other is spectral Doppler. In color Doppler, the direction of blood flow will be color-coded and superimposed on the B-mode image. So we just press the color button and it will show us the color on any fluid-filled structure, any vascular structure. So the hepatic veins that we saw as anechoic before are now showing, are filled with a blue color blood, showing that it's draining the blood away from the liver. The same thing, if we want to see how the waveform is, if we analyze the spectrum of the returning Doppler frequencies, that will have a waveform. So each blood vessel, depending upon the flow velocity and the direction, it will have its own signature waveform, which we become familiar with depending upon whatever specialty we are working in. What probes do we use in ultrasound? So diagnostic ultrasound can use probes that are usually in the frequency of 2 to 20 megahertz. So there are four different probes that I've shown here. What we use commonly in ultrasound, what we would have seen is this large convex probe. This probe is usually around 3 to 5 megahertz. It has a lesser frequency, but it has a deeper penetration. So when we are trying to look at the abdomen, it's a big area we are scanning. It's a deep area we are scanning. So we want deeper penetration at the cost of some resolution. So that's what we use for the abdomen. And crystals are arranged in a curvilinear fashion gives us a sector-shaped image. Whereas a linear probe, is a higher frequency probe, usually anywhere between 7 to 10 megahertz normally. And this high frequency will allow for good resolution, but at the cost of depth. So when we want to see superficial tissues, the tissues of the neck, scrotum, breast, or we want to see peripheral blood vessels, we will use the linear probe. Here, the way the array is, it's a linear array. The crystals are arranged such that we get a rectangular image. Now, when we come to image acquisition, which is probably the most important while doing ultrasound, it's very operator dependent, which is why ultrasound itself is a modality where different people will have different interpretations, different acquisitions. So it's a very operator-dependent modality, and experience helps a lot in getting good quality images. If we can image the patient in a supine position, or he can lie on one side. So if you want to image the kidneys, you can have him lying on the side. A position in between these two would be an oblique position. Then how do we position the probe? The probe can be placed in a transverse plane. Transverse means if you consider the head to foot plane, perpendicular to that would be the transverse or the axial plane. So this is an axial plane at the level of the epigastrium. We can see a bit of the left lobe of the liver, and you can see the pancreas nicely wrapped around the spine. You can see axial section of the IVC and the aorta. So this is an axial image of the, which is acquired from the transverse plane. Now, if I turn my probe in the clockwise direction to 90 degrees to this axial plane so that it is aligned to the head and foot of the patient, that is my longitudinal plane. The same image now turns 90 degrees. So you get now the same, this is the left lobe of the liver, and below that I get the head of the pancreas. So I'm taking a section in this way, like this. And then this is the IVC behind it. So this is a longitudinal section. apart from the axial and longitudinal, to image any particular structure, a portal vein or the bile duct, we can obliquely also change the plane so that we get a good view of the organ we are trying to interrogate. We should apply sufficient gel between the skin and probe. Otherwise, the air that is present between the probe and the skin itself will be sufficient to degrade the image quality. Other factors like adjusting the gain, or do we adjust the depth, the focus, the TTC, will all depend upon what level we want the information from. So now we'll look at some common scenarios where we use ultrasound. First, about abnormal liver functions. Abnormal liver functions can have a parenchymal cause or a biliary cause. I've listed only a few of them for the purpose of the time limitation in the talk. So again, as I said, we look at a lot of images, just how normal looks, and then so that we can know how abnormal look. So we have already seen this image. So these are just two sections of the liver I've taken. So that is the skin surface. As we go down, we are going away from the skin. So this is the diaphragm here looking right. This is all the liver parenchyma. A normal liver will have homogeneous echoes. They are very smooth and fine echoes. We can see the vessels. This is a hepatic vein draining here. In a different angle, I can see the portal vein that's entering the liver. And this small tubular structure in front of the portal vein is a bile duct. Normally, the CBD is seen only to this extent. So it is around 3 to 5 mm. Now we come to fatty liver. So this is again a normal liver. This is a fatty liver. Normally, the liver parenchyma is only slightly hyperechoic or slightly more echogenic than the renal cortex. Whereas when there is diffuse fatty infiltration of the liver, that causes more of the echoes to be reflected back, resulting in a brighter looking liver. So the brighter the liver, more the fatty infiltration. So when we compare this liver and kidney to this, we know that this liver looks much more brighter. So this is fatty liver. But here again, the margins are all smooth in keeping with the fact that this is still in the stage of fatty liver. Now, the next stage of parenchymal disease is cirrhosis. As you all know, nowadays, NASH cirrhosis itself is quite prevalent. So what we saw as fatty liver maybe a couple of decades ago are all now presenting as NASH cirrhosis. So when cirrhosis happens, there is fibrosis within the liver. So the liver gets what is called a coarse echotexture. So this term fine, coarse and all is all just with experience. You keep doing it and then you see that it's not that smooth, it's not that homogeneous anymore, it's a bit heterogeneous. So this is the coarse echotexture of the liver. It will start having a irregular outline. It's even better seen if there is some fluid outlining the liver, as in this case. But even if you don't have fluid and you want to see how the liver looks, we can use a linear probe, not a curvilinear probe like this. We can use a linear probe just to look at the liver margin. It helps to assess the liver margin much better. And there is no ascites. Other changes of cirrhosis will include volume redistribution. So the right lobe shrinks, there is hypertrophy of the caudate and there's hypertrophy of the left. There may be changes of portal hypertension, there will be ascites, splenomegaly. These are all seen secondary to cirrhosis. So I would like to show some of these changes here as well, along with cirrhosis. So this is a big spleen. This is spleen in the long section. So it's enlarged. And these hypoechoic areas that are sitting at the hilum, these are the collaterals at the splenic hilum. Now this is a section of the pelvis where we can see fluid. See this anechoic area, that is because there's free fluid sitting in the pelvis. And these are all bowel loops that are floating in the ascites. If there is portal vein thrombosis, then that leads to what is called the portal cavernoma. So this is a normal portal vein. The blood will flow within the liver. It's a hepatopoietal flow. And this is a spectral assessment. So we see a continuous flow. The flow velocity is anywhere between 15 to 20 centimeters per second. As compared to this, if there is portal vein thrombosis, over time, multiple periportal collaterals will form around the porta. This is called the cavernomatous transformation of the portal vein or portal cavernoma. In the long time, this portal cavernoma, these collaterals will actually compress upon the proximal CBD and will lead to a condition called portal biliopathy. So where you will start having a form of, it's actually a form of obstructive jaundice, where you start having dilated intrahepatic biliary radicals because of these varices that are compressing the proximal CBD. Another cause of chronic parenchymal disease is Peutz-Kieri syndrome. Now, Batchiari syndrome can present acutely. This is an image of chronic Batchiari. In an acute Batchiari, you will have an enlarged, tender liver. There won't be ascites, and there will be acute thrombosis of the hepatic veins. The hepatic veins will not show the nice waveform that we saw before. In chronic Batchiari, the liver develops fibrosis. It becomes echogenic. There may be sparing of the caudate lobe. Ascites will be there. And what's classic on the Doppler is the thrombosed veins will look like echogenic cords, and the liver tries to compensate by trying to drain into whichever vein is patent. So if we see here, there is a thrombosed vein. One of these hepatic veins are thrombosed. So this vein is thrombosed, but it's trying to drain through another patent hepatic vein. You get these comma-shaped collaterals. If there is any one hepatic vein that's patent, they will try to drain through that into the IVC. If all the veins are thrombosed, then these intrahepatic collaterals will try to take the blood out of the liver through the periphery. So this is Batchiari syndrome. Now, ultrasound is a beautiful modality to look at the biliary radicals. It's very sensitive in picking up dilated intrahepatic biliary radicals. So normally we will not see biliary radicals in a normal ultrasound because they are too thin to be seen. But if you have a dilated biliary system, then ultrasound is the first modality we should look for, we should do to look for any dilated IHBR. So they will be seen along with the portal vein. So when we put Doppler, the portal vein will take blood, will show color, and the tubular structure in front of the portal vein, which is dilated without color, would be the biliary radicals. So it is sensitive to pick up intrahepatic biliary dilatation. It is also sensitive to pick up the extrahepatic biliary dilatation. With a little bit of patient positioning and pushing away the bubble gas, we can actually show the CBD to the extent that it is dilated. So if you see here, these are the dilated intrahepatic biliary radicals. This is the dilated extrahepatic biliary. This is a bile duct. So normally the bile duct will not be seen like this. Normally you will just only see the portal vein. But here, in comparison to the portal vein, the bile duct is dilated much more. You can see it. Even the gallbladder is distended. So there must be some obstruction down distally. So these are two images to show. So this is the liver. This is a dilated bile duct. And there is a stone sitting in the CBD. We can see the distal acoustic shadowing from this stone. Here we can see this is an axial section. This is the left lobe of the liver. Here the CBD comes down and it's getting, there is an abrupt cutoff here where it meets a mass in the head of the pancreas. So that is the cause of the biliary obstruction. Now moving on to acute abdomen. There are various scenarios, but I've tried to list some where ultrasound is very good in picking up the findings and where ultrasound is often the first asked modality. Liver abscess. So here, let's see this image. So we are seeing a section of the liver. You are seeing this big cystic area. There are areas that are totally anechoic, which means it's like completely liquefied pus, to some echogenic fluid. So the pus is in different stages of liquefaction. There is increased through transmission. So the area behind this looks much brighter. It may have hypoechoic solid areas within it. If there is air, they will also be seen as bright foci. So this is actually an amoebic liver abscess that is sitting in the posterior superior quadrant of the liver. And that's what is seen. It's close to the diaphragm. While talking about abscess, I would also like to mention hydatid cyst, though it is not actually a cause of acute abdomen, just that it's got some characteristic signs. So you will see a cyst, so a fluid-filled structure. The typical water lily sign that we describe in hydatid cyst is because of the detached endocyst. So that will be seen as this floating membrane within the cyst. This is a water lily sign. Sometimes you can have a multilocular cystic cavity. This is because of multiple daughter cysts within a main hydatid cyst. Another cause of acute right upper quadrant pain would be cholecystitis. So when a referral comes for cholecystitis, the first thing I'm looking for is there any gallstones? Especially, is there any gallstones that's obstructing the gallbladder? So we will have to look for a stone that's either at the GB neck or a small stone obstructing the cystic duct, which has led to a distended gallbladder. We can have a sonographic Murphy's sign. So if you see here, the probe is just placed over the gallbladder. So if I slightly press, there will be some probe tenderness if this is acute cholecystitis. Gallbladder wall will be, in spite of this distension, it will be thickened because of the inflammation. So anything more than 3 mm is considered thickened. Pericholecystic fluid will be there, again, because of the inflammation. And because of the obstruction, there will be a distended gallbladder. Due to the stasis, there will be sludge, which will be seen as fine echoes within it. Now, coming on to the left upper quadrant, this is this is about splenic abscesses, but before that, let me show normal spleen. So we have the patient lying on his left side, on his right side, so that the left side comes up. This structure here is the spleen, this one, and it is seen in relation to the left kidney here. Again, the spleen will be slightly more echogenic than the kidney. This is a normal spleen as compared to this, where actually we are not able to get the full spleen in the image. So there is a splenomegaly and there are multiple hypoechoic lesions seen within the spleen. That could be a wide variety of differential to this appearance, starting from tuberculosis to melioidosis, depending upon the clinical context of the patient. Next, pancreatitis. So while ultrasound is not the modality to diagnose pancreatitis, ultrasound will help look at what could be the cause for pancreatitis, gallstones, or CBD stones, and it would definitely help in following up acute fluid collections or pseudosis. So here we see this is a case of acute pancreatitis, not exactly acute pancreatitis, a case of pancreatic pseudocyst. So we can see the head, body, and when we come to the tail, we can see a well-defined cystic collection. Depending upon the timing, it could be either a fluid collection or a pseudocyst. This is a case of chronic pancreatitis. Now, ultrasound is very sensitive for chronic pancreatitis. It helps to show parenchymal calcifications. It helps to show parenchymal calcifications or atrophy of the parenchyma. We can also see a dilated pancreatic duct nicely on ultrasound. Sometimes the only thing we see in a case of chronic pancreatitis will be just a tubular structure across the midline, which would be nothing but the dilated PD with a stone sitting proximally with significant parenchymal atrophy. And ultrasound is very sensitive to pick up these findings. Next common cause of upper abdominal pain, depending on the right or left side, whichever kidney is involved, would be renal calculi. So again, I will use the same image that we saw before. This is the spleen and this is the left kidney. So when we look at the kidney, we will have a slightly echogenic cortex and hypoechoic medulla. The renal cortex and medulla will be seen. The central area is the renal sinus. It contains fat and it appears echogenic. In this image, we see a calculus sitting in the renal pelvis. There is echogenic area with a distal shadowing. And because this is an obstructing calculus, there is a separation of the calyces. Normally, the calyces will be collapsed. We won't see calyceal separation. So this is hydronephrosis. So a renal pelvic calculus causing hydronephrosis. While we can't follow the ureter fully in ultrasound because there will be bowel gas overlying it, we can see it proximally like we saw at the level of the renal pelvis, and we can see it distally lying below the urinary bladder. So here this is a long section. So we can see this is a long section. So it's a longitudinal section of the bladder. And below this we can see a long tubular structure. This is the distal ureter which is dilated because there is a stone sitting here near the ureterovesicle junction. This is a common site for calculus to be lodged. This again causes the distal shadowing. So this is a distal ureteric calculus. Here we can see a bladder calculus. So there is a well-distended urinary bladder. It's got thin walls. And here there are two calculi sitting with the distal acoustic shadow. Another cause of loin pain would be pyelonephritis. Again, the clinical scenario would be different. Patient with fever, maybe pus cells, loin tenderness. Ultrasound can pick up some of these features, not always, but what are the things that we can see in pyelonephritis? You can see an enlarged kidney, which is why it's important to measure the renal size on both sides and compare them. And sometimes we can see focally an area of hypoechogenicity if there is edema, or hyperechogenicity if there is hemorrhage. Then the typical corticomedullary differentiation, the echogenic cortex and the hypoechoic medulla may not be seen. If you put power Doppler is just an exaggerated color Doppler where you just try to see if there's any flow at all available. You can really increase the gain of the Doppler and you will see that this area is not showing vascularity corresponding to an area of focal pyelonephritis. If ultrasound doesn't show any of these features and you still suspect pyelonephritis, then it would be best to do a contrast CT and confirm, or even a plain CT to start with, to see if there's any swelling or any perinephric stranding. Cystitis. Cystitis is where there is diffuse bladder wall thickening. So we usually ask the patient to come with a full bladder. But in this case, when there's patient, when patient has cystitis, there will be only so much of bladder that he can hold. His bladder capacity itself will get reduced because of all this inflammation going on. So like we saw before in the previous stone with bladder calculus, like if I can show you that. So that's a nice, well-distended urinary bladder. You can see a barely discernible wall. And when we compare that to this, we can see the wall is nice, is thickened. This is a diffuse cystitis, almost 7.4 mm is the wall thickening. Two more cases that I would like to show would be ovarian torsion and an ectopic pregnancy in females. So ovarian torsion, the ovary is starting around its pedicle. So you will get an enlarged ovary. There may or may not be a cyst or mass within this ovary. Now, because of the lymphatic, the obstruction to the lymphatic and venous drainage, the ovary becomes enlarged, edematous. So we get an echogenic stroma. And there will be multiple periphery placed follicles with fluid within them. So fluid transudates into these follicles because of the obstruction. So this typical appearances of ovarian torsion. Not only that, because of this, the ovary will have an abnormal adnexal position. If you put Doppler, there will be decreased blood flow in that. When we compare it to the other side, there may be fluid in the pouch of Douglas. Whirlpool sign is where we can actually see the coiled or circular vessels. This is actually a transvaginal scan. May be seen, may not be seen, depends on what type of scanning we are using. But nevertheless, the presence of an enlarged edematous ovary with an echogenic stroma and peripherally placed follicles like this in someone who's coming with acute pain, please consider ovarian torsion. Ruptured ectopic. So if a woman in the reproductive age group comes with a positive beta HCG, the uterus is empty, which means you are not seeing an intrauterine gestation, and you see hemoperitoneum. So there is free fluid, and also it has fine echoes within it in the pouch of Douglas. If it is extensive, it may also be seen in the Morrison's pouch. It is significant. It is pointing towards a ruptured ectopic pregnancy, and an adnexal mass, which is actually the tubal pregnancy, may be seen separate from the ovary. Coming to the pediatric conditions, four things that I wanted to cover was infantile hypertrophic pyloric stenosis, appendicitis, intussusception, and testicular torsion. Hypertrophic pyloric stenosis, this is the infantile form. So baby will present usually around 4 to 6 weeks of age. Firstborn male is what they have said, and I've also always seen only in the firstborn male. The pyloric muscle is hypertrophied. So the child presents with projectile vomiting of a non-bilious nature. What we will see is the stomach will be distended with fluid. If the stomach is collapsed, you can even ask the mother to feed the child so that you can see a distended stomach. And as we follow the stomach, we will see this hypertrophied pylorus. So normally it will be very difficult. In a normal child, we'll be barely seeing this pyloric wall muscle. So this is a nice hypertrophied pylorus. So even if one muscle is more than 3 mm thickness, or the canal of the pylorus is more than 15 mm, this is significant for us to call it as hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. The difficulty with the scan would be that the child will be really irritable, crying, the parents will be anxious, and you are trying to find this hypertrophied pylorus. But once you get this, you will not miss it. It won't go away because this pylorus will not open. So how many ever times you can scan around and come back to this area, it will keep looking like this only. This is the same thing, a different image where we can see that if I start with one measurement, one is actually the length of the pyloric canal. It's almost 2 centimeters. And the transverse diameter here is 17 mm. And each wall is measuring 6 mm thick. So more than 3 mm, one wall, more than 15 mm canal length is sufficient to make a diagnosis of hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. Once we've seen this, it's very difficult. We won't miss it. Acute appendicitis. So when there is a clinical reference for acute appendicitis, we are going to look at, start with the iliac fossa region. The main thing would be the position of the appendix. As long as the appendix is not hiding behind bowel gas, it's very easy to pick up the finding for acute appendicitis. We usually use a linear probe in children because it is sufficient enough. We want better resolution at the cost of depth. So what we don't want to mistake an appendix is, we should not mistake it for a small bowel loop. So when we see a blind ending structure, which is not showing peristalsis, it is not compressible, a tubular structure with a diameter across over 6 mm, we can call it as an appendicitis. So if we have a doubt, we can just scan the rest of the abdomen and again come back to this area and see, has this changed in its appearance in any way? If it looks the same and you apply some compression, it doesn't change. And we can even get probe tenderness while you're applying compression. These are all features in favor of acute appendicitis. We may see an appendicolith. If so, it's not seen in this picture. It will be a bright, the proximal mouth of the appendix. We can see a bright echogenic foci with shadowing. Intussusception. So before going to intussusception, let's see this normal gut signature. So normally gut will have an echogenic lumen, that is echogenic mucosa and the submucosa. These will be echogenic. Next layer is a muscle layer, which will appear hypoechoic. And then there is an echogenic serosa. So this is a normal gut signature. What happens in intussusception? A part of the bowel is going into another part of the bowel. So we get in short axis. So when we see two bowel moving into each other, if you see in short axis, it looks like a target or a donut sign, which is nothing but concentric alternating layers of echogenic and hypoechoic areas. So we basically scan all over the abdomen. Everywhere you will get bowel gas. Usually bowel gas means it will be like this, a bright area and no attenuation distal to it. And then suddenly you will see this area where there will be layers of hyperechogenicity and hypoechogenicity because of the different layers of bowel wall sitting within each other. So once we've seen this, you can go around and come back to it. This will be still sitting like that in the same position. In children, often it is ileocolic intussusception, whereas in adults, depending upon the cause, the type of intussusception, it may be colocolic or ileoileal, depending on what's causing the intussusception. Now the same thing, if you want to confirm it, you can also, we have what's called the pseudo kidney sign in the long axis. So if you turn the probe at 90 degrees, what happens is the mesentery within it will contain fat and blood vessels. So this will give the appearance like a renal hilum, and the edematous bowel wall around it will look like the parenchyma. So it kind of looks a little bit like the kidneys. This is called the pseudo kidney sign in long axis. Even if this is difficult to interpret, just remember these concentric layers looking like a donut is classic for intussusception. Torsion testis. So whenever we suspect torsion, we have to compare both sides, the affected side and the other side. So usually I am talking about classic images. It's never always like this. There will always be gradations, but what would classically look like in torsion is that the affected area, the affected testis should appear enlarged, heterogeneous, and show decreased vascularity on Doppler. So this is a normal testis with homogeneous echoes, and this is the abnormal testis, which is heterogeneous, it's engorged, and it's not showing significant vascularity on Doppler compared to the other side. This should be differentiated from epididymitis. So in young adults, if this is considered as a differential, usually the testis will show normal echogenicity. It is epididymis that is affected to start with. So the epididymis will be enlarged, hypoechoic, and that will be the one, usually the tail of the epididymis is where it starts, which will show increased vascularity as compared to the testis. And we have to take all these findings in clinical correlation as to, is this matching? It's better if I have the surgeon next to me so that he's also convinced that what we're looking at is torsion or epididymitis. Now, last part of the talk is looking at trauma, which is a fast scan, focused abdominal sonography for trauma. So we have all these different areas that we've got to scan. So basically, we are scanning the liver, the kidneys, the spleen for any visceral injury. We look at the Morrison's pouch, the lino-renal space, the pelvis for any free fluid, and looking at the lung basis for any pleural effusions. The main purpose of fast scan is that we pick up free fluid. So it's a quick scan, it's done within 5 minutes in the ER. We have a portable machine. And if we see free fluid, the ideal step next would be to take the patient for CT. If he's hemodynamically stable, take him up for a contrast CT, because there are many injuries that can be missed in ultrasound. Sometimes you can pick up hematomas. So here we can see a hematoma in the liver with fluid around the liver. Here there is a hematoma in the kidney. This is a hepatorenal space, and you can see there is a subcapsular hematoma here, which is looking bright and echogenic with fluid in the pelvis. So basically, if you pick up fluid, the next step, if the patient is stable, is to go for a CT. I think at this point, I'd like to end my talk. And shall I stop sharing, ma'am?
Yeah. Over to you, Dr. Jayaraj.
That was an excellent talk. I think it was a beautiful overview. Sri Priya, you've done justice to the science of ultrasound, starting from its generation and the highlights that you have provided. Mainly the surgical interest for the large surgical group that is viewing us. And I thank you for that lovely presentation, because it can set the discussions going. And I feel that if I have to say something, it would be on two things. One is, like she was very clearly pointed out, Dr. Sri Priya, that ultrasound is operator dependent. And why so? Let's think a little bit back, and it all depends on our training. And I must say, operator dependent is so fine, because if I see the same patient again hours later and do the imaging, I might get it a little different depending on my mood. So that's why I'm saying it's all the planes of ultrasound are dependent on the operator, and two, and the skills, and three, these planes are often trying to get the pathology of the organ in the best image that we can get to prove our point. So the plane may not be the same as the axial plane of the patient or the coronal or the sagittal plane of the patient. Be related to the organs. So each organ, as we know, is aligned differently within the abdomen. And so the operator has to go along the plane of the organ that would give the best kind of imaging for all these pictures that we see pathology in. And so ultrasound is really unique, and that's why operator dependent. Not only is it operator dependent, but also the fact remains that it is patient dependent. We see beautiful images in lean individuals. If you look at obese people, they are put into a fix. Then if you look at gassy individuals, half a job is gone. So gas can come in the form of aerophagia from an anxious patient, or gas can come in by the inherent old age and hypotonicity of the bowel as one keeps aging. So these two things, plus trauma and prolonged immobilization due to some spinal or rehab patient, we have a lot of problems in trying to do the ultrasound. In ultrasound, one of the major things is it's so convenient for the patient, it's not painful. And for the sake of the operator, I must say that we mustn't move the patient too much while doing the scan, because many of them don't like the cold gel and they don't like the repositioning and the pressure of the probe. So all these little factors add to the value of the ultrasound, and it is operator dependent in all essence. One more extension on the operator dependence is the fact that we want to go to the root cause of the problem. Now, Dr. Sri Priya has beautifully brought out the elements of cirrhosis, and then something more has to be done, whether there is portal hypertension or not. So when we want to see that, just by ultrasound alone, not only do we look at the ultrasound morphology of the organ, the size, the echo characteristics, and of course the nodularity, as you beautifully pointed out, but also the venous flow. And the portal venous Doppler, I believe, in the coming years must be part of a workup of any cirrhotic patient that the surgeon would like us to examine. The portal venous Dopplers would help us define the thrombosis within it, the flow directions, which will help us whether there's a reversal of the portal venous flow. Of course, we don't do pressure recordings, but still, it gives us a fair idea about the evidence of portal hypertension, including the indirect signs that come on with it. So, so much is the operator dependency. Whether we want to go to the root cause of all these pathologies, or just give a superficial report and get away with it. Now, added to that is the fact that the FibroScan and the liver NASH that Sri Priya beautifully brought up, I think there's a lot of confusion about the elastography that is being used for liver and liver NASH changes, the steatohepatitis. They're trying to give a scoring system, and a lot of things are going on. The hepatologists and the liver specialists do depend on the FibroScan and all these things, because they're time tested. But with time, there are certain key features in ultrasound that can give us a very easy clue. Coupled with all this, the NASH comes with some difficulties because the focal fatty change within the liver does not appear or occur as we expect. It is depending on the inherent blood flow within the liver itself, which is dynamic by itself, and it varies from segments to segments. So we find focal fatty changes in some areas are accelerated. In some places, the cirrhotic process goes more into segment-based scenarios, and then generally it becomes generalized, affecting most of the liver segments, except maybe the caudate lobe and the disproportionate in the size of the right lobe and the left lobe. These are all indirect signs that the ultrasound of the liver would help us gather an idea about the type of change, chronicity of the disease that's going on. And so that was a lovely presentation, Sri Priya, because it gives a lot of thought for discussion. And going into the depths of it, there's a lot of issues there that as an ultrasound operator or a scan specialist, you must give profundity to what we see, not just see a superficial finding. I feel hurt sometimes when I see impressions saying, just describing the report back again on the impression. That means the operator hasn't got a clue as to how he should proceed or help the clinician carry on with his work. He needs impression with a direction. And that, I believe, is really very important that we focus on the nature of the problem, try to identify the root cause of it, and all this is operator dependent. We have to be flexible while doing the ultrasound too. And as Dr. Sri Priya gave you a preview of what we have on hand, multiplicity of probes is the essence of every machine. So when we see a lesion that is coming up into the surface, coming up into the abdominal wall, coming up to the skin, we have to move from the depths, identify the full the relationships of the lesion that we see, the characteristics, and then the superficiality of it, and we keep increasing the probe frequency as we come towards the superficial areas to see whether the abdominal wall is involved, the extraperitoneal fat is involved, the peritoneal reflections are involved, and every little thing that we can see just by ultrasound. The hallmark of a good operator would be that if we can see on ultrasound what we see on other cross-sectional imaging like MRI and CT, then we are done. That would be the acid test for every little operator who wants to be a good ultrasound specialist. So I believe that is very important before we start off on every little examination. And as Dr. Bharti is here, and she'll always side with me and with our great professor, Professor Arkat Gajraj, I never fail to mention him in many of my forums because he makes us feel curious about every little thing that we see. And not only curious, find out what it is due to and share it with your juniors so that we all come to know as quickly as ever and we can go on to higher things. This is what he said. You teach everybody what you know and you can go on to higher thinking. So I think that is a very good philosophy that I keep following everywhere, and I'm happy to do that even today. A lot of these issues on acute abdomen, one of the problems that we have in acute abdomen is the speed with which it is coming into the emergency rooms, and the surgeon is always in a hurry. He'll say, come on, do this, do that, and I want to take him to OT. We are all pushed into some great pressure. So now today, emergency ultrasound and emergency imaging has become a science by itself. So it runs along with the ER systems, and we find that ultrasound is part of all ER imaging that we have to do. That is emergency radiology, I'm sorry for that. So, but all casualty is complete with the ultrasound. An ultrasound is often the extension of the clinical hand that we use. And then we have to quickly give an opinion. So critical care reporting is something that we have to focus on today because it starts off at the bedside and runs into the OT. And then we are happy overnight when the patient is safe. So this is the philosophy with which we have to work with speed. And ultrasound does provide that. I'm happy to say that. So we have to work as a team. There's no way I can just identify a finding and keep quiet. I see free fluid and be happy. No, where is this fluid coming from? And that is where an immediate intervention by putting a needle into the fluid, identifying whether it's blood or whether it's perforation, all these little things would really help in giving you a quicker diagnosis at the bedside. That I feel is so important in the whole scenario. We have difficulties too, particularly with ileus and gas within the patient and immobilized patient, difficult to move or change positions. So sometimes urinary calculi are missed. But then let us go to the background and the physiology. Where do these stones get obstructed? Very often, they're often seen within the kidney. And believe me, the urologist who comes in to say, boss, don't keep telling me about renal calculi. Okay, it's the fact remains that renal calculi don't cause any great issues if they are at the tips of the medullary pyramids. Only when they start moving down, they do cause colic. So a renal colic is expressed by the stone moving off from the medullary tip and then coming down the calyceal system and obstructing at several points. And what are those points? They can get caught at the infundibulum of the calyx. They can get caught at the pelvic-uretric junction. And after the pelvic-uretric junction, it's got a free run unless there's an overlying vessel somewhere which is blocking the ureter. But most important, it gets stuck at the vesico-uretric junction as the ureter enters into the uterus muscle. So invariably, when we ask the patient to fill the bladder, we or during the emergency itself, press down and identify the VU junction, 75 to 80% of our stones are identified at the VU junction. And the important thing here is define this size of the stone, because if the size of the stone is less than 10 millimeters, it can be moved just by conservative means and hydration of the patient. So that increases the movement of the ureteric stone into the bladder and there's a big relief. So during the passage, we must keep our analgesics ready. And there you are, the radiologist guides the stone down into the bladder and out of the patient. I believe this is the way to go and help our clinicians determine how soon and how far we can help in the process of clearing the pathology for the patient. And other things that I just want to quickly mention is the trauma, the speed with which it happens. We have a multidisciplinary action here. Some orthopedic guys coming in, dashing in for looking at the fractured limb and then hidden lesions that many of us miss in spinal injuries. And there have been several instances where after the surgery for a spinal trauma, for an abdominal trauma, some abdominal liver laceration, we find that the patient's not recovering or not moving his limb. Why? Because the spine is forgotten, the neuro examination is not completely done, and then we all feel going back why we didn't look at the spine. So cross-sectional imaging today has taken over most of the ER, and ultrasound is just an aid, but in many centers where trauma is the base of all emergency services, we do what is known as a whole body scan. And I'm going beyond ultrasound here because coupled with the ultrasound that we do, we must do what is known as a whole body CT. And that gives us an entire spectrum of the body and the polytrauma that the patient is subjected to in many a bad accident. So these are little things we've learned along the way. And I know there are too many things. Vidya, I'm so sorry, we're running out of time. So I'm not going to hold this forum too long. And I'd love to add to the value. And as I already discussed with Dr. Sripriya, there are so many things to discuss in this forum and for people who are interested. And I'd be happy to do that for you. So thank you, Vidya. With this, I will stop my the discussions here. And if you want to ask some things, we both, Dr. Sripriya and I, will answer.
Bala and Saubhanika, any questions?
Hello.
Hi, Saubha. Hi, Bala. Hi.
Very nice. Very nice. Excellent.
Thank you.
Shripriya and Dr. Jairaj, I want to ask you about one different aspect of this ultrasound. See, the concept of a surgeon performing ultrasound is not new. I think it used to be there from my residency days. And in fact, during my MCH, they used to insist that we do at least 4 or 5 ultrasounds in patients so that we use the ultrasound machine which used to be stationed in our ward. from just being a diagnostic tool, means useful for us in many ways, especially in pediatrics, be it securing a line, trying to look for loculations, interception reduction. It's a nightmare if you have it in the night, we don't have radiologists, and then we have to shift the entire the patient, the sisters, the entire armamentarium reduction used to shift to a place where radiologists was available. Now we started doing it ourselves. So the concept of a radio, I mean, a surgeon performing ultrasound is not new, and it has definitely got its spectrum widened because we are able to use it for a lot of interventions also. As a radiologist, how much you think you're comfortable allowing the surgeons to do?
Very, very diplomatic answer I want to give for this. For two reasons. I'm very, very clear that the number of radiologists available are less. And that is why we need more radiologists in the service. But in the interim period where we cannot man all the shows everywhere, particularly in the mucosal areas where only a surgeon is trying to make his decisions, I go back to what Pope said years ago about the abdomen. The probe is the extension of the hand. So we have to be generous in allowing the surgeons to do that. But then, let's be very frank. Ultrasound needs a lot of training. And if you want to do good ultrasound and a very focused ultrasound, as I clearly reiterated in the portion of my discussions, it's very important that the person who keeps doing it again and again and again, like how many things can you guys focus on? Will you be trying to look at the safety of the patient with your surgery? Or would you want to do a scan to just get over that intermediate uncertainty of your clinical reasoning? So let's be very correct here. We've been trained for that. When we are trained for such things, we pick up things a little better. I'm sorry, it's a forum, mixed forum, I can see, but really it makes a difference. And if you have a radiologist on hand, please make the use of his service. But if you don't, then please feel free to use the basic ultrasounds that you all know, knowing fully well that ultrasound by itself will not give you all the answers, definitely not. And that's where the radiologist comes in, because he says, come on boss, don't waste your time on ultrasound, go ahead with a CT that's just nearby the ER, and there you are, you get an answer within hours. Now do you want that, or you want to wait for days? So this is the difference by having a radiologist around. We are basically imaging specialists, and we like to be proud and say that we try to get the diagnosis for you. And in the way that you can plan your surgeries and do it well, not, an emergent situation is always a hurry for everybody. There can be errors here and there, and then we have to compromise for those things. It's important that, I'm not sure whether I should be discussing all this in this open forum, but it is important for all of us to reason out every little thing we have and use all the facilities we have on hand to get the best for our patients. I hope that's answered, Bala. I'm sorry.
Partly, yes. Wherever you can,
please go ahead. It's always... Yeah,
we would have seen n number of ultrasounds being performed. You might understand the anatomy when you show it. But it's a totally different ball game when we have to hold the probe and then see. But when I've been doing ultrasound only for very specific conditions like interception reduction. With a diagnosis of interception, it's not difficult for anybody to follow the mass. The reduction, at least we can do that much, especially this is more out of necessity when we not got radiologists in the night, we are forced to adapt to this. And definitely, like, I'm now comfortable doing it myself. Of course, I don't do a diagnostic study. I don't say interception present or not. A child with suspected interception, ultrasound done, and I don't have a radiologist because you are a rare breed, especially pediatric radiologists, you don't get them in the middle of the night.
Where are you working, Bala? We have to find that first.
Yeah, that's a nice question, Ma. Go ahead.
Let me not tell you that hospitals where radiologists are not available in the night.
There are many places where radiologists are not available around the clock. Let's accept that. Even in a metro city like Chennai, and definitely in the rest of the country. So, I'd like Dr. Ilango to come in on that, because even in the ER, when you have radiologists on call who are coming from home, you might need some basic skill as a trauma surgeon or on call surgeon. So, Dr. Ilango, your take on this?
Ma'am, I had a very different experience. I was a part-time ultrasonologist 20 years ago. I think I did that for 7 years. So I had a pretty good experience. So I was, my surgical career was started very slow. In 2000, when I came out, I probably was operating 2 or 3 cases and I was an assistant to 5 surgeons. So evening times I was free. So I was asked to cover this ultrasound service. So I was taught on the job. I was doing basic ultrasound. My father was also trained in ultrasound. So I learned a bit from him. I actually became skilled in even doing obstetric ultrasound, then started doing interventions. So I will disagree with the fact that it is not learnable. It is learnable. There is a rule in Madurai Medical College, if Ilango can learn everything, anything, anybody can learn anything. So I would actually encourage every youngster to pick up ultrasound. I'd never learned ultrasound with the idea of using it as a tool in surgery. But today I'm a transplant surgeon. And my colleagues say that Ilango's life lies in that ultrasound. So I finished my transplant with a thorough examination of the graft with an ultrasound. So I do call the radiologist at times. They are much better at interpreting. I have to give it to them. But I have learned to do it myself. And that skill actually grows with the years. So the there is a competition in this, actually. Radiologists want to intervene and they became interventional radiologists. And surgeons are turning the tables back. So there is a lot of image-guided surgery. There is a Professor Gian Menes, I think he's from Brazil. He teaches in IRCAD. It's funny because most of the procedures he's doing, I've been doing for several years. It's good to learn how to diagnose an abscess, drain the abscess, drain fluid collections, do your own interventions. So some of the hospitals where we don't get interventional radiologists all the time. So I got used to draining pancreatic collections, liver issues, pretty much on my own. So it is a skill. It is an extension of your hand. And I think it's beneficial to learn the basic diagnostics, the ability to handle the probe, the ability to localize and puncture the fluid. All those things are basic skills that I think an MS general surgery, a PG should know. Trauma, it is helpful just to probably pick up big lacerations and splenic ruptures and some free fluid. Apart from that, it's very difficult to do. I've seen it's not good in perforation because it misses interloop fluids. But still, something is better than nothing, and it's definitely better than the surgeon's hand now. Thank you.
Dr. Bharti, your take on this? Any tips for trainee surgeons who want to learn a little bit about ultrasound?
Not everybody is as gifted as Ilango or as lucky as Ilango to have had exposure to ultrasound. So many surgeons are still dependent on us, which I'm happy to have. But yes,
I was a radiologist assistant, okay?
Yeah, good for you. I'm happy that you had that exposure and you're able to do things confidently. But most people can't do that. And, you know, in many emergency departments, they have an ultrasound machine parked in the intensive care itself, so that little fluid collections, you know, want to look up for ascites, if you want to do a 5-quadrant ultrasound for trauma and all that, many intensives themselves do ultrasound, and they use it also for venous access and stuff like that. But when it comes to regular flow of departmental cases, I don't think the surgeons have time to do all those things. And to me, ultrasound is as much an art as it is a science. And it's a labor-intensive department of radiology. So nowadays, not many youngsters want to do ultrasound. They are all armchair radiologists who want to only do CT and MRI. So that's why I think the specialty is being sort of eroded, probably, because we are giving it away, that's why. But still, having said that, it's a very, very useful tool in acute abdomen, especially as Shripriya has very beautifully demonstrated. And there are also, it's not just the abdomen, there are other fields of surgery also where ultrasound gives a lot of information to, for example, for the thyroid, for endocrinologists, for vascular surgeons, to look for peripheral venous and arterial blocks. All that, I don't think the surgeon has time to do those things. And we are the ones who have to detail all this for the surgeon. And I love doing pediatric ultrasound too. It's really an art when it comes to pediatrics. Bala, I know I have done some of your, seen some of your patients too. You know, you have to have a knack with children for that. And it's not easy to diagnose in a child who's crying and moving all the time. So it's a very intensive department, and I enjoy doing it. So, but not all radiologists might. So that's a good, yeah.
Anjali, would you like to say something? Anjali Dawale?
Yeah, madam. Wonderful lecture by both the faculties, and the surgical view is also beautifully given by Dr. Bala sir and Ilango sir. Now on this forum, madam, I am also practicing in the interior part of the Maharashtra as a general surgeon. So basically in 2012, I have been trained for ultrasound breast at Dr. Selvi Radhakrishnan at Chennai. After that, I came back with her certification and all. I applied for the ultrasound machine at my area, in the municipal corporation area. In that time, because of the PCPMDT stringent rules, nobody has allowed us, or they said, you are not permitted. Then this story, when I was going for application, they were saying you are not allowed. This story went on and they were not ready to give me in return anything. So after certain period, I applied for a higher station, like deputy director and all the other faculties who were at higher station. And they said, are you a postgraduate? Then I said, yes. This why the municipal corporation is rejecting and all. After that, because of the persistent efforts, I could get the ultrasound machine after 4 years of the battle. That I have to convince people that when I am ready to give in writing, that I have nothing to do with the antenatal screening, etc., what you want. And after that, we could able to do that. Now, after that period, madam, when I applied during this process, I had a lot of struggle. Like first, the committee doesn't know whether you are a certified ultrasound. My purpose was to have a breast clinic and a breast lump evaluation. But later on, with these stringent rules, I decided that I should learn more better. Then I had an application in the medical college at my area. There, they have given me house officer post after the 12 years of MS. I joined as a HO there. I used to practice in the night time at my area. They have given me certain duties at radiology department. For 1.5 years, I was just a writing person. The radiologist was dictating the terms. I was writing the report. And meanwhile, in this 1.5 years, I would say that my experience has doubled, and I could able to do now all the emergency, non-emergency. Even I have started the varicose vein ablation at my center. Even because of the ultrasound, I am able to do the BCT procedures and many more things I could do. So my advice to all the youngsters in the audience and all the surgeons, that for a surgical person to read an ultrasound image is not at all difficult, because we have a complete image of anatomy, that is one. We have a complete evaluation of the pathology, because every section, every pathological or every surgical specimen we cut out, we take out from the body, we always cut it. We may see what it is. And because of that image in mind, I think it is very easy for a surgeon to read and to interpret the ultrasound. One more thing I would like to highlight, that many of the radiologists, they do not do the venous Doppler in standing position. They do it in the either sleeping position. That is also very wrong. And because of the standing position and perforator localization, we have started many HINA-like staining. So these are upgradations, and this is a clinical upgradation. Because of this small modality, your perspective of surgical career changes a lot.
I would agree with you on that as far as anesthesia goes as well, because ever since we started, you know, touching the probe and using it, the entire focus of your work changes and the precision changes. Does anyone else, Devpriya, you have something to say?
Ma'am, can I add to what Dr. Bala said?
No.
Bala, basically, you said there's nothing to be scared about the probe. It's basically the knowledge that we have that will tell us what we can interpret. So if you are practicing as a urologist, every urological condition you would have seen, like the other doctor said, you know, you would have operated, you will be the best at that. And as you say, as we keep scanning, we get good at it. But the thing is, will you pick up an appendix or will you pick up some retroperitoneal nodes? So what the mind knows, you interpret what you know. So the whole thing with ultrasound is in 6 months, I mean, there are all these courses that are doing. So you can, the more you keep looking at these images, the more they make sense to you. But what we do in our 2-year or 3-year training period is we look at the whole body because we are not limited to any specialty. So the way surgical training is going, every surgeon seems to be very good. Liver surgeons are very good in interpreting liver Doppler. They can do their own Dopplers, which is good. But and you should use it maybe to guide your, it is a surgeon's stethoscope after all. But when it comes to answering a general question, acute abdomen, what does this patient have? Then if we just go down the route that we know, I know, so you can exclude stones, but will you be able to pick up other findings? So that is where the experience that Dr. Bharti was saying comes up. So, you know, when we do our general medical radiology training through the years as a first year, second year, third year, we keep getting better at picking up skills. It should be used. There is nothing to be scared of the probe, but to how much extent you are extending into somebody else's territory, as far as you know, you may be good in your super specialty. Can you be confidently tell that you've excluded all the other organ systems as normal? A radiologist can. Whether surgeons can, I don't know. I think it depends on your experience.
I think a surgeon can never replace a radiologist. What I'm trying to say is, we don't do the diagnostic scans, but you can use the tool to help us in instances, at least when you are not available.
Definitely. No, you should use.
Is a classical example. Yeah. And for example, there is a empyema. If you have placed an ICD, it's still not draining. You can look for loculations. You don't have to wait for the radiologist to come the next day. You can direct the ICD there. So you can improvise your surgical
treatment. The probe is there, the gel is there. I mean, it helps.
Definitely. And we can only learn ultrasound from the radiologist. We definitely cannot.
I'm sure Sauba is doing all the obstetrics. Sitting. Obstetricians have taken the field fully. They have limited themselves to their specialty, but it's just that when it comes to surgeons, surgical field, there is so much actually, even in pediatrics, when we say acute abdomen, there is so much. So will we be able to pick up all the findings? Whereas a dedicated pediatric radiologist would be, it's just the experience that counts, you know, and as the other madam said, you know.
Dr. Sripriya, can I interrupt you here?
Yes, sir. Yes,
I mean,
sir.
We should not hair split a specialty, you know. We are still a developing country. I mean, if we go on hair splitting the specialty, like, we are not going to reach all the people who actually need medical care. I think this is like, you know, being a transplant surgeon, if I still insist on doing every appendix that walks inside the hospital, I'm not going to do any justice. I think radiologists should gradually pass on what they have developed over these years to those individual specialists who can use them at the bedside.
And all I'm saying, there should be a formal training, sir. I think without a formal training, I'm not saying you shouldn't do, of course you should do, but unless we get some kind, a sufficient period of exposure, we may be missing things. We may.
Yeah, I agree. Like, I'm not saying we are the experts to look at every part. No. See, I may be looking only at the liver and the pancreas, and the patient may have a ovarian cyst, which is much more bigger problem than what I am seeing. So I agree with you. We need a person to look at it in a very different way. But I also feel that the radiologist should train the individual specialist to look at the problems in their own area of interest so that I mean, there are much more better things for a radiologist, a specialist radiologist to do.
Yes, sir, agree.
Priya, I also feel it depends on, like all the others said, where you are working. So if it is a corporate practice, any day it is much safer for us to, you know, get the words spelt out by a radiologist. I don't think I will be doing an obstetric scan.
Okay.
And I would like to have a report, formal report. I would not even, you know, go with a handwritten report. I'll wait for the printed report before I actually sit and talk to my patient, because I'm sitting in a huge corporate hospital and the patient is also going to expect that. So it depends on the place and the availability, which is the most important fact, like what Bala said.
Agreed, fully agree.
That's true, yes. If you, you know, when you go to the PHCs, and actually we did a course almost 2 years. We had sent out junior radiologists and sonologists to train obstetricians in PHCs to do their obstetric ultrasound, basic ultrasound, because poor patients cannot afford to go, especially from the villages, they cannot afford to go to bigger centers for advanced scans. So the obstetricians were able to at least pick up a heartbeat to measure the crown rump length of the fetus, and, you know, pick up at least major anomalies like anencephaly and hydrocephalus, or, you know, something grossly wrong with the heart. We taught them to do all that, actually. It's not that we don't want to teach you, but the thing is, I'm sure you have enough work of your own, and I'm sure even Dr. Ilango, you must be having enough work to do of your own. And when it comes to routine ultrasound, I'm sure you're not going to be sitting and doing routine ultrasounds. It's in the emergency scenario that you need to do something quickly when you cannot access a radiologist, or it's there's no time for to get another person to come and do it. In that scenario, there's absolutely no harm in knowing a few basic things, and especially in emergency medicine. But in routines, yes, I don't think, Sava, you will have time to do an anomaly scan, because I would take about 25 to 40 minutes to do a detailed anomaly scan in a fetal echocardiography. You surely won't have time to do that. So it's like that.
We are not trained also.
Specialty in medicine, and not everybody has the time to do it. You have better things to do of your own. And we are trained to look for certain things, like Shri Priya said, you may look only at your organ of interest, but I'm trained to look all around the entire abdomen. So I will pick up something more than you would if you only looked at the liver or only looked at the liver. That is definitely here. It's not that we don't want to share our specialty with you, but I think you should know where to stop and then hand over to the radiologist. And we should also be generous enough to accept that, you know, it's not something that you can't do. Yes, you can in an emergency situation. And I'm more than willing to demonstrate a few important difficult situations to surgeons or obstetricians. And I think it's the benefit of the patient. If we keep that in mind, I think we will stop bickering about everything in medicine generally.
Summed it up very beautifully, Bharti. And I agree, like, we are masters of our circumstances. And if you feel that you can do something to help you along, to help the patient finally, please go ahead. I mean, it's all an individual enterprise. And not many people would be like Dr. Ilango, who is passionate about liver and liver things related to it. So he will go forth and identify everything. He opens them up. He sees the structure. He's more happy to do that. Fine, great. And I can give you any number of examples where surgeons have become radiologists. And they become very good radiologists, believe me, and they're also very good interventional radiologists. Interventional radiology was actually started by a surgeon who turned into a radiologist. So there's several examples of cross movement of these professions and the expertise. And sorry to accept that. So feel free to use it if you're comfortable doing it, confident in doing it, and for the benefit of the patient. But ultimately, I do believe that we are all part of a larger team. And when we work in coherence, then I think things will be much, much better and much more lively. And for the sake of the patient, I think we should all form the teams that we can in our own ways, in our own comfort zones. And that would be the message that I would like to share with all of you.
The point I was trying to make was, if we need to do something in an emergency, sometimes you should have done it in a non-emergency setting before, or you need to do it many times before you can actually function in a high pressure situation. So my point of choosing this topic for Dunnigan surgery group was that surgeons should take interest in ultrasound and learn the basics. First is even to interpret images. Sometimes patient comes with images done somewhere else. So there are people, if we cannot interpret images, then you know, that's not a good thing. That every time you need someone else to interpret images for you. So if you keep on looking at CTs, then you can interpret a CT. So similarly. And second thing is for simple things like, you know, putting a chest drain or like draining an abscess at 2 o'clock in the morning or something. If you need to do that, you should have had some basic knowledge and some basic training before you can do it in an emergency. Obviously, everybody will love to have an interventional radiologist available 24/7 or a CT scan and MRI in-house 24/7 with interpretation, but that's not the reality of our country. So that was my intention of choosing this topic. It was not actually to think it who should do what or who shouldn't. So Deepriya, you have anything to say?
Madam, I would like to say that anybody has an experience of endoluminal ultrasound, which has come in a big way, like endoscopic ultrasound along with the laparoscopy. Because unless until we have a basic ultrasound knowledge, we cannot interpret the EUS output. So, Ilango, Setu, any experience about the endoluminal ultrasound devices, which has come in a big way in PRD or upper esophageal or upper GI surgeries?
Endoscopic ultrasound is being done mostly by gastroenterologists, not so much by radiologists, because it's a part of their endoscopic procedure. So most of us are not trained to do endoscopic ultrasound, because the gastroenterologist completely takes care of that. So if you don't want to learn that, then you have to go to a center which does endoscopic, lot of endoscopic.
Normally, they are not training even surgeons, even GI surgeons to do EUS.
That is what
I completely restricted to Shanti.
Trans esophageal echocardiogram is also a big thing. Even that is sort of very limited use and a limited number of people who are actually trained to do that. But it's very useful if you want to look at pancreatic pathology. Yes, it's really very useful if you know how to do an endoscopic ultrasound, because you go right up to the pancreas. You have nothing, no gas in the stomach to obstruct your view. It's a fantastic modality, but very, very... it's a niche specialty, I would say.
Yes.
It's not possible for everyone to learn.
Yes, Deepriya. Yeah. We can't hear you. We can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, a little loud.
See, I'm a general surgeon for people who don't know me, and I've spent majority of my career working in surgical gastroenterology. As a fresh PG, the difficulties I encountered was one is that this complicated intra-abdominal infections like pancreatic collections that requires intervention to drain it minimally, invasive interventions, and post-operative collections. And that's when we are stuck with, we are waiting for an intervention radiologist to come and help us. And it was a decade ago. And at that point, we used to wait for an intervention radiologist to come maybe once or twice a week or on call, wait for this person since morning, make the patient wait. So at that point, I this is my personal journey. I decided that I'm going to learn ultrasound. I spent about a month with Dr. Bobji Ketai, a very senior radiologist in a private scan center. And in that 1 month, I realized that I'm not going to master this, you know, in a few months or a few weeks. I know it requires hours and years of training to get it right. So having said that, I mean, this is my my opinion. Having said that, surgeons, we read images every day, ultrasound, CT. So what we see every day, at least the basic thing is we need to interpret it. So we will be in a position to do justice to the patient. So when you, so for my advice for younger surgeons would be, to first develop an interest, because it's again anatomy. People who are attracted towards anatomy only take up surgery. So anatomy, surgery, radiology all go together, pathology as well. So first thing is try and learn, and there's plenty of resources available. Learn and discuss. The easiest way to learn radiology would be from a radiologist. So I make it a point to call up the radiologist to tell them why I need a scan. So if it's possible, because it's just a phone call away. So the easiest thing to do would be to call up and say, this is what is the clinical scenario, this is what I'm expecting, but we need to rule out these things. So if you're able to convey that to that person who's doing an ultrasound or CT, most of the problems are solved. Second is, these days, patients don't come straight for a clinical consult. They come with an ultrasound done by somebody else for some reason, or they themselves go to get a scan done for some problem. So many now these days, what we see is they come with a report and they want you to treat the report. So again, in those situations, it's wise to go back to the person who has done the scan to find out what happens and to clinically correlate and then decide what is required in this situation. And there are times when you're not very happy with the scan. So only you will know you're happy with the scan only when you have read it, interpreted it time and again for many years. So once you've developed that eye for detail, then you know this is a suboptimal scan or it's not a great report. You would want to discuss or repeat one if required. And when it comes to intervention, even now, I mean, Chennai City is loaded with radiologists. Now that I am into private practice, I realize there are plenty of radiologists, and almost all of them are too happy to discuss any case with you when people in institutes or private practice. The dearth we have is interventional radiologists. As Dr. Sri Priya commented, we need a formal structured training. See, if you look at any of the UK websites, any learning portal, there'll be plenty of courses, ultrasound for surgeons. We don't have any formal course in our setup here. See, when it comes to obstetricians, like what Bharti Madam has said, they see patients every day, and every private clinic has an ultrasound machine in the consulting room. They can do a basic scan to see if the heart is there or not. That's a basic they can do. Of course, for the higher scans, they have to refer it to a trained person who can do it. So we need some kind of a structured training. And again, this will help somebody who is organ specific and who is able to spend that much of time in a clinical situation to get his or her hands on for a few years to become an expert in that. So that is my take. And when it comes to interventions, I am a bit egoistic as a surgeon, because I've seen interventional radiologists do interventions, especially post-op collections, pancreatic collections. They're so scared to, you know, make an incision or put a larger drain. As a surgeon, I would love to know the anatomy, where exactly the collection is, how deep the skin it is. And if I have that anatomy and that radiologist by the side, under that guidance, I would be more confident to insert a drain. So that is what I wanted to put across. And I really liked the presentation, especially the urinary catalyst, the VUJ. I remember Dr. Bob G. Ketai. He is a very senior person. You wouldn't ask for a CTKUB. He would diagnose all urinary calculus in ultrasound. So he used to put a probe in the bladder, look for the urinary jet. He says there's no jet on the right side, there's a calculus here. So that's the beauty of operator-dependent ultrasound. I fondly remember him today after listening to this lecture. Thanks so much.
Dr. Sujay, would you like to say something? Please unmute yourself.
Yes, ma'am. So nice discussion, actually. And what I would like to say is, yes, you're not going to ever replace the radiologists, the surgeons. But I think every surgeon, basically every clinician today, should have a familiarity with the ultrasound probe. Like, I think we have worked together and we have seen how you use the ultrasound to locate your nerve blocks. And I think basically even insect, all the OTs today have an ultrasound. And difficult breast lumps. It is, we are today telling all our residents to go down to the ultrasound suite. Look at the radiologist doing the radiology, the ultrasound, and try to see where they're locating their breast lumps, the ultrasound of the neck and all that. So that when we do have a difficulty in locating, and when we want to get a clear margin to remove breast lumps and all that, an ultrasound would definitely be much more useful than just a clinical or a intraoperative assessment. So I think, yes, every surgeon should have at least a familiarity with the ultrasound. They're never going to replace the radiologist interventions and all that. But I think they should have familiarity at least to use it intraoperatively or in emergencies, like locating a vein to cannulate a vein, to locate a lump, or to drain an abscess or anything as necessary.
So we are almost, you know, 1.5 hours into the program. Pata, would you like to say something? If anyone else has any questions, please raise your hand or, you know, unmute yourself. Yeah.
Vidya, actually, I was a little skeptical about your title of ultrasound for surgeons because, you know, I have come to believe that ultrasound has become some sort of obsolete a thing, because we are so much into CT scans and MRIs and so on, and Sri Priya has brought back ultrasound into the fore. But again, I don't know how much she succeeded in making surgeons believe that everybody should know how to do an ultrasound. Actually, frankly speaking, surgeons are the least interested people in learning ultrasound, because I see anesthesiologists use every day in our OT, I see gynecologists using, I see breast surgeons, vascular surgeons, intensives, etc. But surgeons, for some reason, we don't use. Actually, in the All India Institute where I was trained, we used to have an ultrasound in our ward, but nobody used it because we never knew how to sort of use it. We never been taught properly. I tried a couple of times to look at the gallbladder, and that's all I could do. But other than that, it's very, very difficult, because anything other than a gallstone disease, we always want a CT scan. A CT scan has become so very comfortable. Now, actually, I'm very, very interested to here, Jairaj saying that some surgeons have turned sonologists and international radiologists, because this is news to me. Because, you know, I think only unemployed surgeons do that, because Ilanga was not doing anything for a couple of years, and, you know, that's how he got into ultrasound, but now he doesn't use it anymore. Once it's become, you know, that's the way it is, because we surgeons, I don't know whether really you can push them to do, because they have to operate on something, they should have a sure diagnosis, and they'll not be their radiological diagnosis and somebody else's. And Vidya, you say you should know how to interpret ultrasound. Actually, every patient comes with ultrasound report and some images, they all look the same. The only thing I can make out is the gallstones and nothing else, actually. Frankly, you can't interpret ultrasounds. Ultrasounds are interpreted by ultrasonologists, and which ultrasonologist, JPS says he can talk to the ultrasonologist. I can't talk to an ultrasonologist, because I know who, frankly speaking, before the radiologists came into the fore, ultrasound is done by non-radiologists. Even some top radiologists in Chennai are not qualified as a MD radiology. Actually, the ultrasound is much, much, even in the periphery where I go once in a while, a lot of people who do ultrasound are MBBS only. They don't have any sort of structured training. But then I'm in a luxurious place all my life where some excellent radiologists are this, I couldn't learn, but I don't know whether I can learn any further. So I'm really perplexed at this juncture. If I have to learn, or any surgeon has to learn, how he should go about, I'm sure the radiologist will not have time to teach you the basics, and the surgeon will not have time to learn the basics. So I think I'll stay there where I am, looking at the CT scans and listening to our radiologists, what they say.
I think trainee surgeons have rotation in radiology. Maybe they should, you know, actually go and sit in the ultrasound suite and watch the sonologist doing it, and, you know, learn. You may not be able to do it when you're having a busy practice, but during training, I think you need to take some time out to do that. That's what I would say. But Dr. Bharti wanted to say something.
Yes, you're right, Vidya. I agree with you. In fact, when I was in my original firm, Precision Diagnostics, we used to get DNB PGs from Sundara Medical Foundation used to do a rotation of at least a week or two in my center to learn some basics, at least to look at what organs look like, what pathologies look like. So it's actually a good idea to do, because when I was doing MD radiology, I had to go and spend 3 months in general medicine and 3 months in general surgery to know, to refresh my memory about those things, so that I could be a better clinical radiologist. So similarly, I think during training, you guys can come. Pata, you had the luxury of always working in corporate hospitals. But when you go to smaller hospitals, not all of them will have CT scans. And, you know, a ureteric colic, I have spent a lot of effort, and in fact, I've injured my shoulder several times applying pressure, trying to pick up the ureteric calculus, because either the patient didn't have access to CT or he could not afford CT, which is a very, very real thing in our country. Not everybody, like in the US, nobody will do ultrasound for, in the West, they won't do ultrasound for any ureteric colic. Straight away, the patient goes for a CT, plain urogram. But in our country, still our patients cannot afford to go to a CT suite. So we have to we have to know how to pick up these kind of emergency situations in ultrasound itself. But like you said, yes, I can train you. If you come to me for a month, I'm sure, Patta, with your kind of brain, I will make you a very good thing. But you don't have the time, honestly.
Take a sabbatical, Patta. Take a sabbatical. Dilesh, I saw you come in briefly. Would you like to say something?
Hello, ma'am.
Hi.
Good evening, ma'am. I'm from Nasik. It was an excellent talk on this radiology in the resurgence. I think every surgeon should know the basic radiology. And nowadays, all PGs should be trained in rotation radiology department.
Thank you. You are able to convince trainee and junior surgeons to take you seriously. Thanks for your input.
Thanks.
Thank you, Sri Priya, for that excellent talk. You should also listen to Sri Priya's talk on liver imaging. It's really mind-boggling.
Vidya, a minute. Rajgopal Shenoy wants Sri Priya to do a talk on interventional radiology.
No, I don't know interventional.
Somebody said they want a talk on interpretation of CT abdomen. So maybe that we can do in rotation next time round. That would be a good thing. And surely, we've already had one session on interventional radiology. We can do more if some specific thing people are interested. Please do post it on the Learning General Surgery Facebook page. What topics you would like to be discussed in Marvelous Medicine episodes, and we'll be happy to get the faculty and moderators together so that we can all learn. So thank you for all your inputs. Dr. Jairaj, would you like to sum up before we say bye-bye?
Well, I'm glad that we had a lot of these discussions, because in various many corners, we get this little people wanting to do something more than what challenges them. You know, whenever they get a challenge, they want to learn something more, and the passion continues. So we are ready to teach, as Dr. Bharti said. Sure enough, it is our passion, and we'd love to share what we know, and we'd be definitely willing to do that. So if there is something that they all really want to know, we are happy to do that for you all in the way that it would help you. So sure enough, experience and the challenge has to meet somewhere, and we have to get the best things going. And I always believe teamwork is very important in all this.
So I'd like to thank you all once again, and hope to see you next Thursday with yet another episode of Marvelous Medicine. Thank you everyone for joining. Stay safe.